pleasure to participate in this torch relay, and I'd like to thank Dr. Yeotkwan Lee for the invitation to contribute to this effort. So today I'd like to present some information on the arterial pulse being a sign of life and also a formidable challenge in the measurement of blood pressure. The presentation is actually constructed in two parts. Part one, I'd like to take you on a brief personal journey along the illuminating pathway of interdisciplinary science. And that's my pathway in the professional discipline of biomedical engineering and associated disciplines along the way. So the journey consists of two parts. There's a physical journey and an intellectual journey. The physical journey started in 55 when we migrated from southern Italy to the northern part of Australia. I grew up on a tobacco farm, and it wasn't easy going to school. Went to boarding school to learn to live in a community. And in 68, I enrolled in an engineering degree in a university college in North Queensland, which now has become James Cook University. And in 1970, I continued the degree third and fourth year in Sydney at the University of New South Wales. And it is there, when I was engaged in the degree in electrical engineering, that I developed an interest in biomedical engineering. The intellectual journey actually started during the PhD at the same university. And there was a postdoctoral period in the Department of Physiology at the University of Leiden in the Netherlands. And there was a period of research fellowship, of course, on unstable research grants at the time at St. Vincent's Hospital in Sydney. And then there was a long academic career in biomedical engineering at the University of New South Wales in Sydney, and a latter part as a research professor at Macquarie University. So I just like to explain the various parts there. And I'm now currently Professor Emeritus in the Faculty of Medicine, Health and Human Sciences at Macquarie University. So the first part, I had two supervisors. One was in engineering and one was in medicine. And so the work for the PhD involved a relatively new field in understanding blood pressure as a pulsatile phenomenon, which accounts for wave propagation and propagation characteristics that is common to electrical transmission lines. So the arterial system could be modeled as electrical transmission lines. It was fantastic intellectual challenges. And I learned quite a lot about the combination of physical sciences, biological sciences, physiology, animal experimentation, signal analysis applied to clinical data. And there's a lot of collaboration with clinicians and cardiologists and surgeons. So just to bring back some context, post-Second World War, there was the field of hemodynamics was developing, and some prominent exponents of this field were Donald MacDonald and John Womersley. They collaborated. Womersley was a mathematician and MacDonald was a physician, but they had an interesting collaboration that involved understanding the relationships of blood pressure and flow as pulsatile phenomena. And so you can see that an important work was done by Womersley, that he was able to solve the fluid flow equations in circular tubes, and came up with a beautiful relationship between pressure gradient and blood flow, where you could actually calculate blood flow by measuring blood pressure and knowing the parameters of the vessel. And this was a big breakthrough. And this enabled this English collaboration, which was extended by other students, Michael Taylor, Michael O'Rourke, who was my supervisor, I'm still collaborating with to this day. And this was the Australian connection. And there's a whole line that goes through this type of understanding of hemodynamics. And so the postdoctoral research involved a period in the University of Leiden in Holland, in the Department of Physiology, Department of Physiology of Physiological Physics, the very same department where Eindhoven did all this groundbreaking work on the electrocardiograph, the ECG. And there I was involved in dynamics of the coronary circulation, involved in isolated heart experiments, understanding the microcirculation. And so this is a paper we published with our colleagues. And the person I worked with was John Laird. Now, the connection between my going there and that person was, in fact, the counterpulsation, the intra-aortic balloon pump. Now, why is that important? Because the balloon pump, the balloon is placed inside the aorta and it inflates during diastole. And that's like a big pulsatile wave reflection during diastole. And this was part of the understanding of the hemodynamics we were working with. And so what's important also is that John Laird was involved in the design of these balloons that were being made for this purpose. And this was in the 70s. And this technology came from people working in the space industry. So this person worked on the Apollo 11 mission that sent people to the moon. And these were engineers that were involved in gas dynamics, and they knew what they were talking about when they were designing balloons. And so it was fascinating. But it was involved in the early counterpulsation use in the Netherlands. And then he got this job as a professor in physiological physics, and he set up a research group. The other part was came back to Australia after two years in Holland, and was a research fellow on research grants in Sydney. We did lots of work, but one of the most important piece of work we did was two studies in China over 2 years, 1981 and 1983. Two papers, important papers, were published. And what this involved, essentially, measuring pulse wave velocity in population. So the speed of the wave of the pulse in the arteries is an indication of the stiffness. And what we found was that this measure of pulse wave velocity was much higher in the Chinese populations compared to the Western populations. And in fact, it was higher in the two separate Chinese populations. Now, why was this important? Because it showed the big difference in vascular stiffness that was involved in the prevalence of hypertension. So these two populations had a different prevalence of hypertension. And so this gave us a much better understanding of how to understand the origin of high blood pressure. And it brought forward this idea of understanding vascular aging. So you can see that one population, in terms of for the same value of pulse wave velocity, the same vascular parameter, one population occurred about 30 years later, so that the different populations have different ways the blood vessels age. The long career in biomedical engineering as an academic involved a series of levels from lecturer to professor over the years. And this involved interdisciplinary teaching. You can see a list of various areas that I was involved in teaching, and also a whole list of different areas of interdisciplinary research around the idea of cardiovascular research related to vascular function underpinned by the pulsatility phenomena that are seen in circulation. So vascular stiffness, arterial modeling, signal processing, and then and some of these applications to even things like cerebral circulation. So after that long career, I moved to Macquarie University as a research position. And what was fascinating was that finally, I thought, after all this time, I could have some research time to understand what I've been doing. And so started as an Australian School of Advanced Medicine. And which is now the Faculty of Medicine at the university. And more than 60% of the total output in terms of higher degree students and thesis examination, research funding and research output was done during this time. And so now the laboratory is headed by Dr. Mark Butlin, and we've been involved in basic research and applied research. So idea of pulsatile function, mechanical effects and cellular signaling related to vascular dementia, blood pressure related research, and that's what I'm going to speak about, an aspect of non-invasive cuffless measurement of blood pressure. So that was part one, and that was the journey that's taken me, and it was fascinating in terms of the intellectual input that I've had, again, from colleagues and people in the field, and it's been extremely fulfilling. So we are still involved in this type of research, and I'd like to talk about this aspect of the arterial pulse, and essentially, and also as an integral part in the measurement of blood pressure in the some innovative advances that have been made. So we know that the arterial pulse has been a sign of life from antiquity, and these are slides that are shown in many forums. The pulse is felt, and so various aspects can, diagnostic aspects are related to the arterial pulse. And this was before one could actually have had a picture of the pulse. We didn't know what it looked like, but we know what it felt like. And so the pulse was seen once it was able to be described, and it was described by mechanical advances made by a number of people during essentially the 1800s. Mechanical devices applied to arteries that were palpable. And this was a very famous piece of work done by a young Irish Indian doctor, Akbar Muhammad, where he was able to produce graphical representation of the arterial pulse, and where he was able to then make some diagnostic pronouncements like lead poisoning, typhoid fever, and so on. So, and this was before the sphygmomanometer, before one could actually measure blood pressure. The arterial pulse was used as, of course, a sign of life, but also a diagnostic feature. But the important part, important advances were made by the introduction of the sphygmomanometer over that time. And the important people are Ribarocci and Korotkov, where we know that their techniques are used to sense the arterial pulse in the arteries and then associate certain phenomena. So the sounds appear and disappear. And here then we're able to measure systolic and diastolic pressure. Now this is being used, it's still being used since this time. This technique has not changed. What has changed is the application of the pulsations in the vessel in terms of different ways of measuring blood pressure. And so now we have the auscultatory technique, where we measure systolic and diastolic pressure by listening to the sounds. We have the oscillometric technique, where the oscillations in the cuff are registered, and these features are used to measure mean pressure and then extrapolate to measure systolic and diastolic pressure. And of course, the original way was used, which was used with the cuff, was palpatory. So you feel the beginning of the pulse, and you associate that with the pressure in the cuff, and that only measures systolic pressure. Again, these techniques are used widely, but of course, they only have intermittent measurements. So the cuff sphygmomanometer gives intermittent measurements. And so the measurement, of course, is not pressure, not arterial pressure. It is cuff pressure. So the measurement of blood pressure with a cuff sphygmomanometer is the pressure in the cuff, but it is still a pressure. And then there are surrogate quantities that are associated with the arterial blood pressure. And of course, it's blood flow, presence of the peripheral pulse, and the various sounds. Now, fast forward to the current situation of blood pressure measurement, there's a very big interest in understanding ways of eliminating the cuff so that one could obtain potential continuous measurements of blood pressure. Now we have a large array of these devices that can measure blood pressure or purport to measure blood pressure without the cuff. And of course, they use surrogate measures such as pulse wave velocity, the parameter I was talking about before, that is related to the level of blood pressure. And so what is involved here is the sensing of the arterial pulse, of the peripheral pulse, and sometimes with an ECG, so that the time differences between the ECG and the pulse, or to between two different pulses, is used to estimate the travel time of the pulse. Or there is analysis that is done on the arterial pulse itself. So these devices carry out this type of measurement. And the question that is being asked at the moment, literally as we speak in various forums, there will be, in October, there'll be an International Congress of Hypertension where these problems will be discussed. The question is, are they reliable? And are they reliable for real purposes, for example, diagnosing and treating hypertension? So what are the expectations of these cuffless devices? One of them is that they're unobtrusive. They don't get in the way. They could be embedded in wearable devices like watches and so on. And so they can produce a continuous measurement of blood pressure, monitoring continuously. And this idea, this characterization of blood pressure in this way could probably change the way we understand blood pressure and hypertension in view of looking at blood pressure profiles, which could be a better characterization than the conventional ways of measuring blood pressure, for example, the ambulatory blood pressure monitoring devices. And of course, if that is able to be done in a continuous fashion, one could collect massive data. And big data is one of the areas that is being investigated in medicine, which is going to improve the treatment of individuals at the individual level rather than the population base. Now, what are the quantities? What are the surrogate quantities for cuffless measurement of blood pressure? And as we said, it's pulse transit time. So, and this is because this pulse wave velocity is related to blood pressure because of the properties of the arterial wall. And it's called the nonlinear elasticity. What this means is that the elastic modulus of the arterial wall depends on blood pressure. So if we have pressure and area here in an artery, the curves are not linear, which means that the slope of pressure area will depend on the level of blood pressure. So if one were able to measure arterial stiffness, then we could then extrapolate to blood pressure. And that's the general idea that is used in some of these cuffless devices. Now, and this is only true, this association of pulse transit time or pulse wave velocity, this association is true only for the arterial wall. And remember that these devices measure peripheral signals, which is also part of the microcirculation in the peripheral arteries. So the association has a biophysical association, which is the pulse wave velocity associated with arterial stiffness and the properties of the geometric properties of the arteries. And that's the famous Mohns-Korteweg equation. So we know that if we can measure pulse wave velocity, we can have an association with arterial stiffness. And it is that stiffness that is then associated with blood pressure. And so, but of course, there are a few caveats that these associations are theoretically true for thin wall tubes, where the wall thickness is much less than the diameter of the wall. Now, what's the challenge for cuffless blood pressure monitoring? The challenge is that it's probably a problem of both measurement and physiology and how these two are integrated. And so what this means is that, for example, the physiological factors that contribute to changes in blood pressure, such as stroke volume or nervous sympathetic activity, could also affect the measurement that is being done, for example, the pulse transit time, because it is done via a peripheral pulse, and that could produce an error in this association. So just to illustrate this point, I'd just like to describe some recent study we did with the late Dr. D'Arienzo, who's also the senior member of IEEE. And what this involved, measurement of pulses at four different locations, in the forehead, the ear, and the finger, and with the seismogram at the chest. So with these measurements, one could obtain accurate measurements of times, of transit times, from the opening of the aortic valve to the arrival of the peripheral pulse in the ear, the forehead, and the finger. And so analysis of these signals produced quite interesting results. So this particular set of experiments involved 22 people where the blood pressure was changed using a cold pressor test, a hand grip test, and a cycling. All of these interventions are to increase the blood pressure. And so the various parameters were measured: blood pressure in the finger, pulse arrival time, which is from the ECG to the foot of the wave, and pulse transit time was between the peak of the seismogram and the foot of the wave. And from these, we could actually calculate a cardiac parameter called the pre-ejection period or the isovolumic contraction time. So these are the protocol. So between each intervention, there was a rest, a 5-minute rest. And these are the results, and this is the problem I was talking about. So all of these interventions here caused a change in blood pressure and systolic pressure. And if we look at the bottom here, the pulse transit time showed very little change with the cold pressor test or the hand grip test, even though there was an increase in blood pressure. But with cycling, there was a big change. Now, for the same blood pressure, what this says is that when we are measuring these surrogate measurements here, we are not getting the same measurement for similar changes in blood pressure, depending on what the intervention is. And these are the physiological effects I was talking about that may affect the actual measurement. So it becomes a challenge that has to be met with these new devices. And so with the pulse arrival time, there was a bigger change. And remember, the pulse arrival time includes the cardiac parameter, which is not related to the stiffness or to this measurement of blood pressure. And so this effect is a confounding effect that has to be sorted out when these devices are used for situations like diagnosing and treating hypertension. So the conclusion in this case is that, in fact, the robust approach to cuffless monitoring of blood pressure must consider the extent of integration of aspects of measurement, such as sensors, signal detection, noise thresholds, and so on, and the underlying physiological mechanism that is common to the effects of blood pressure and these surrogate parameters that are being measured and analyzed. So, the accuracy and the magnitude of these changes with cuffless devices can only be meaningfully improved with mitigation of these errors due to the integration of measurement and physiology. And so this work is an example of what I started talking about, that these aspects of biomedical engineering, biomedical science, are interdisciplinary approaches. And the first part of my career was extremely informative in bridging these areas. And so with that, I'd like to thank you very much.
I am Professor Dr. V.R. Singh, Chair of EMBS Chapter, Delhi, India. So I am thankful to Dr. Yut Kwan Lee for inviting me to speak about the chapter and its activities and the research work going on in Delhi and in surrounding areas. So mainly I will give the insight of our research work on sensors and systems for healthcare applications. So this is my area of research also. And you can see that I am a director data scientist of National Physical Laboratory in New Delhi. And presently, I'm director of PDM University and NJAC professor of Netaji Subhas University of Technology. In IEEE, I am a life fellow of IEEE India. And then I give you about the EMBS, IEMS joint chapter activities. So we have several activities. So arranging every month theme talks, seminars, then conferences on relevant topics related to biomedical engineering and healthcare in India and at global level. So here I give you some activities. So apart from lectures and talks, we organize technical discussions, field trips, societal mission projects, and developmental activities. So you can see here, so this is a special talk on 4th October, which is our IEEE day. So if you see in the center about Delhi chapter, so we have student members, fellow grade members, and regular IEEE members. So we have the celebration which we have organized. We organize IEEE Day every year with a special talk on that day. Then other activities we take like Arthur Days celebration, then Happiness Day to differently abled persons, like we had one on 22 August 2019, and several WIE Women in Engineering events, debates. And here our branch was awarded the best orator activity. We also organize our activities with other chapters. Delhi section, and our technical associations. So we participate in art and activities, Delhi section activities, All India Council activities, and with various research and development institutes. This chapter we established in 2004. The membership strength is like this: full members 61, total, regular 38, senior member 22, fellow, so life fellow, I am life fellow, 1, student members 47, with SB, student branch, PDM University, and then we have the increase every year, 5 to 7 years, 7%, sorry. So if we see our technical activities, so we organize for the student various technical activities in the form of special talks, special projects, and special programs. On educational side, so we have arranged entrepreneur programs, internship programs to give in-depth knowledge about startup projects. So many students, our member of IEEE, they participate. And then we have inter-institutional programs also for the benefit of the student and others to enhance their career. Value-added programs are arranged from time to time. And this is one example. So we have oversee implementation of IEEE brand governance guidance to protest IEEE brand value on all marketing, collateral, and digital efforts. So then we have other competitions, discussions. So here we are showing the projects which have been prepared by the students. And we are starting such projects as a demo. In healthcare, we have many programs related to EMBS activities. So India healthcare treatment is one big program, you can see. So we have medical tourism in India. And you see the figure, medical tourist visited in 2010, 5 lakh, then 60,000 doctors graduated from Indian medical colleges. So this is increasing day by day. And you can see the figure in 2017 is $18 billion business. So if you see why they are preferring India, because we give good facilities, So we have good hospital facilities, good doctors, and the cost is very low. Low waiting, and we have many present facilities, and we organize the accommodation also at low cost in the hospital or near to the hospital for the relatives of the patient. So they like India for their treatment. One project is cancer treatment and diagnosis. So we have full facilities with radiotherapy, chemotherapy, then hyperthermia is a new technique, ultrasonic therapy, and cryosurgery. So it depends upon the type of abnormality the patient has. If it is deep-seated tumor or cyst, say inside the brain, so we use focal ultrasound. So this is the local tumor hyperthermia. And the tissue temperature in this case is from 42.5 to 45 degrees for 30 minutes or longer. So the rise in temperature with focal ultrasound is, you can see, 2.5 degrees centigrade. It is non-invasive, can penetrate effectively to mid-body plane at frequency with tissue wavelength of a few millimeters. So this can be focused within the tumor or in the treatment volume. So best for local hypothermia is for tumor, deep-seated tumors, to destroy, to treat deep-seated tumors, like sitting in the brain. So this is good for deep, large, and highly vascular tumors. Can control coagulation of greater volumes of tumors with focus ultrasound, or we can use some time cryo surgery. If I go to high intensity focal ultrasound, as I said, the temperature is raised by 2.5 degrees in this case, and we try to focus the beam, ultrasound beam, at the tumor or other disease. So we go for geometrical treatment and planning. Then we go to thermal treatment planning. Then we adjust the position of the probe, ultrasound probe. Then we go for volume location and then execution, and then temperature measurement with the help of a temperature sensor. So this is the working of this high intensity focal ultrasound. So if we compare this technique with other techniques, so you see the frequency. In radio frequency range, it is 0.5 to 1 and 10 to 30 megahertz. In microwave, it is more than 300. In ultrasound, it is 0.5 to 5 megahertz. So this is RF heating, local current field, capacity, then inductive coupling, then radiation source, direct contact. So these are the names of the techniques. If we go to focusing, so in microwave, not good. In ultrasound, it's very good. Localization in ultrasound is excellent, whereas other modalities are having poor or less than ultrasound. Advantages in case of RF, you see simple, cheap with RF source, can heat large volume, good for superficial, but not good for deeper tissues. Microwave is good for superficial conditions like skin cancer. We can diagnose and treat. But if you see ultrasound, it's good, flexible, and we have a depth, dose radiation due to focusing, good penetration, and biological effects minimal, and equipment is slightly inexpensive, good heating, and no effect on surrounding tissues. If you see disadvantages here, we give for RF, it's invasive, excess heating. In microwave also, difficult to predict thermal patterns. But in case of ultrasound, only coupling media is sometimes problem, like a gas to tissue, like bone to soft tissues. So then we have to go for attenuation problem solving. Limitations are you can see the presence of mites, but in case of pregnancy in women, so we use the ultrasound very carefully. So these are some pictures of our instruments. First is deep-seated tumor treatment. So you see here, this is the focal ultrasound transducer cyst. This is electronic, associated electronics. And then we take the temperature measurement from this point. This is the transducer. Okay. This is the focal system. How we go for it, beam plotting. And you see here, it's about the neuro nervous system. Okay, so similarly, we go for piezo composite material we have developed ourselves. So this improved ultrasonic transducer performance. So acoustic impedance is reduced for better matching. Unwanted surface waves avoid it, and then feature common facilities are good. for electromechanical coupling systems. So here you see, we take sometimes tissues. So this is a femoral tissue, breast tissue. So we try to measure the ultrasonic parameters like velocity attenuation. Then we take the measurement of jet, acoustic impedance. On the base of these parameters, we then try to design and develop our transducer and sensors. Here, this is a tumor dissection and tumor under focal ultrasound. These are the temperature sensors. At different points, we measure the temperature. And then we design and develop the instrument accordingly. This is the plot of our attenuation and ultrasonic velocity. Okay, this is the picture of the output power, and it's a piezo composite materials. This is the one instrument we have developed, the focal transducer. So we have a collaborative approach also with the different parameters. So we engage in cross-team collaboration to align necessary components and stages to manage outcomes of our deliverables. So then we have here which improve ultrasonic transducer performance, as I said, and we go to next parameters. Apart from our research being carried out in the hospital, in our university, in our labs, we have collaborations with other institutes, other hospitals, government organizations, and abroad. I give you some examples. In Canada, we have collaboration with University of Toronto. So here we work on acoustic ipsilateral studies in the ear, tympanic membrane development, that means mechanical eardrum, electroacoustic sensor study. In TU Delft, Netherlands, so we work on microsensors and systems. KU Leuven, Belgium. So we have the project on development of portable acoustic lithotripter for kidney stone disintegration. At the Institute of Cancer Research, University of London, University of Surrey, and Southampton, so we collaborate on nano cancer research. In Germany, in PTV, so we work on ultrasonic power meter and dosimeter for safety studies. In Korea University, South Korea, so we have the collaboration on nano micro sensors. So these are the glimpses of our research work. I hope our students will benefit from these ideas. Thank you.
Good day, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I would like to express my special thanks to the IEEE EMBS Chapter Development Committee for giving me the opportunity to share my research work in this IEEE Day EMBS Chapter Torch Relay Public Webinar. The title of my talk today is Dyslexia Recognition in Children Using EEG and Deep Learning. I hope that at the end of this talk, the participants will get new knowledge and ideas to use it in their research work. This is the contents of my talk. First, I will introduce the words used in the title, show you how the work was carried out, reveal the results, and finally summarize the whole thing. Studies have shown that 5 to 12% of the nation population has this their learning disabilities. Of this population, 5 to 10% has dyslexia. It has been reported that in Malaysia, based on the statistic in 2017, 80% of the public primary school children has dyslexia. In the population of school children aged 7 to 12 years old, 12% has learning disabilities in both reading and mathematics. Dyslexia is a neurological disorder that causes a child to have difficulties in reading, writing, and doing mathematics. Signs of dyslexia include read and write very slowly, confuse the order of letters in words, put the letter in the wrong way around. For example, if we ask them to write B, they will write D. If we ask them to write P, they will write Q. And then they have poor or inconsistent spelling. They also find it hard to carry out a sequence of directions. If dyslexic children are not properly treated, they will fail to master the basic skills, which will result in long-term damage in their self-esteem. Dyslexia, a sample of dyslexia writing is shown on the right side of the slide. It is important to identify dyslexia at an early stage to provide appropriate support for these children and to design and develop an effective teaching pedagogy. We can also help them to master the basic skills by providing training to them. Writing is a complex process demanding cognitive operation. When we start writing, we will look at the words that we want to write. So the information will travel from primary visual cortex area to angular gyrus area, where the word is recognized, then it moves to Wernicke area, where the full meaning of word is understood, then it moves to Broca area, where the sequence of movements is arranged, and then finally move to the motor cortex, where electrochemical neural commands are sent to the muscles that we use for writing. For the normal subject, the information flows through a different pathway in the left brain where sounds are met to words. For the dyslexic, the left hemisphere brain does not function. So dyslexic children use the right hemisphere of the brain to read and to write. Conventional method of dyslexia assessment uses a checklist of questions where proficiency in phonological awareness, proficiency in rapid automatized naming, and reading fluency evaluated. It is carried out by an educational psychologist or a dyslexia specialist. This method is time-consuming. Example of methods used to assess dyslexic children aged 7 to 8 are shown on the right side of the slides. Example of words are big, box, hand, girl, milk, and house. Various methods are used to detect dyslexia, such as positron emission tomography, PET, functional magnetic resonance imaging, fMRI, and electroencephalogram, or EEG. PET and fMRI have limitations. For example, PET relies on blood flow and uses the exposure of radioactive injection. fMRI relies on head motion, which severely degrades the measured signal. It is not suitable for children who has a reading disability. EEG offers several advantages. The time resolution of EEG is very low, down to microsecond. It enables brain activity to be tracked more accurately. It is a non-invasive and painless method. EEG records electrical activity of the brain through electrodes placing on the scalp. EEG are divided into five frequency bands. They are delta band, 0 to 4 hertz. It is for deep sleep. Second, the theta band, 4 to 8 hertz for drowsiness. Alpha band, 8 to 13 hertz, indicates relaxing. Beta band, 13 to 30 hertz, indicate active concentration. And the gamma band, which is above 30 hertz, indicate concentration. Learning activities that involve writing and reading are associated with beta band, 13 to 30 hertz. People with learning disabilities or impaired mental processing may not produce as many gamma waves. Long short-term memory, or LSTM, is one of the deep learning methods. It is a deep recurrent neural network architecture used for classifying time series data. LSTM has feedback connections and can process both single data points, such as images, and entire sequences of data, such as speech or video. It has been used in recognizing speech and handwriting and diagnosing dyslexia using different techniques other than EEG. The popular methods in classifying dyslexic EEG signals are support vector machine, k-nearest neighbor, and extreme learning machine. To the best of our knowledge, there is no report describing the implementation of deep learning to recognize EEG signals from children during writing. And in the studies of dyslexia in children using EEG, most researchers focus on reading disability, not writing disability. A few researchers have used deep learning and other techniques, for example, horizontal eye movements and letter writing images to detect dyslexia in children. They examine the performance of another type of deep learning, which is convolution neural network, and also machine learning techniques in distinguishing dyslexia in children. This is the overall process of classifying EEG signals of dyslexia using LSTM. The process includes EEG signal acquisition, EEG signal processing, EEG signal analysis, and finally classification using LSTM. Note that in this process, there is no feature extraction stage. In this work, 54 subjects, normal and dyslexic children aged between 7 and 12 years old, took part in the signal acquisition stage. The EEG signal were acquired using wireless biosignal acquisition system called Genotilus with 8 channels. The electrodes are placed on the subject's scalps at locations FC5, SC6, T7, C3, C4, T8, P3 and P4. These locations are related to reading and writing activities, which were identified from our previous work. And we also use a graphics processing unit operating at a frequency of 1.32 gigahertz. During EEG acquisition, the subject performed 5 activities, which are relaxation for 40 seconds, writing 3 simple noun words, writing 3 complex noun words, writing 3 simple noun words, writing 3 complex noun words. In this work, we use noun words, which are words that do not have meaning. This is to ensure that the children use their writing skill without having to memorize any words. The words used are those have letters that often get confused by dyslexic children, which are B, D, M, W, C, E, P, Q, and many more. In the EEG signal processing analysis, the EEG signals were filtered using a notch filter to remove power line interference, a high-pass filter with a cutoff frequency of 0.5 Hz to remove the baseline drift, and a bandpass filter to capture the alpha and beta band for analysis. A fast Fourier transform analysis was employed to look at the signal's characteristic. We have found that the frequency spectrum pattern and frequency ranges of EEG signals obtained during relaxation and writing for dyslexic and normal children are different. Dyslexic children produce a higher frequency of EEG signals during relaxation and writing activities compared to normal children. In this work, LSTM was used because it is suitable for classifying and predicting time series. Before we classify EEG signals of dyslexic children and normal children, the dataset was sorted according to their lengths because the EEG sequences data has varying length. We divided the data into training and testing. 70% was used for training and 30% was used for testing. The LSTM networks has an input layer, hidden layer, and output layer. The input size is for the input side, we use 8 EEG channels, and then for the LSTM layer, it has 100 hidden neuron, and then we use 2 outputs for the fully connected layer. Evaluating the LSTM performance, training accuracy was calculated, mini batch size and the maximum epoch was were varied. The mini batch size was varied from 5 to 30, and the maximum epoch was varied from 10 to 100. These are percentage of accuracy and also computation times of LSTM for various mini batch size. We found that a mini batch size of 20 produces the highest accuracy, which is 96%, and the fastest process is achieved when the mini batch size is 30, which is 82% accuracy. A mini batch size of 20 was selected because it provides the highest accuracy. Graph shows the percentage accuracy and also computation time of LSTM for various maximum epoch. The best maximum epoch is 60, since it produces 98% of accuracy. We can see here that when we varies maximum epoch, okay, when the maximum epoch is increasing, the computation time also increases. Using the maximum epoch of 60, it takes only 4 minutes 37 seconds to complete the classification process. Using the optimal, mini batch size and maximum epoch, which are 20 and 60 respectively, the LSTM model produces an average accuracy of 99.3% using the training data and 82.6% using the testing data in identifying signals of dyslexic children. The STM sensitivity is 100% and its specificity is 85.4%. Distinguishing EEG of normal subjects, the sensitivity of LSTM is 98% and its specificity is 88.2%. These results demonstrate that LSTM is capable of recognizing dyslexia from EEG signals accurately. Using the combination of LSTM and EEG, dyslexia could be recognized in children at an accuracy of 82.6% without the use of feature extraction. LSTM can be used to detect dyslexia from EEG signals. However, more data have to be used to get better accuracy. Other types of deep learning, such as convolution neural network, gate recurrent unit, and other types should be studied to get more accurate model. I would like to express my gratitude to IEEE EMBS Chapter Development Committee 2022 for the opportunity to speak in this webinar. To IEEE EMBS Malaysia Chapter for their support. Ministry of Higher Education Malaysia for providing the research grant, and Universiti Teknologi Mara for providing the facilities. My heartfelt gratitude to all the Dyslexia research team members, which includes my research partner, Honorary Professor Dr. Lee Yu Kwan, and my postgraduates and undergraduate students for their contribution to the research. Finally, thank you to all participants for being a wonderful audience. Thank you.
Coronary artery disease is the world's number one killer. It affects 6% of the general population and up to 20% of those above 65 years of age. Coronary artery disease causes 20% of death in Singapore and 33% of death globally. The number of coronary artery disease cases is growing due to aging and higher prevalence of diabetes in Singapore. Computer tomography coronary angiography is the first-line investigation for coronary artery disease. However, CT report generation currently requires 2 to 4 hours of CT specialist time depending on complexity. There is no efficient toolbox to analyze calcium score, epicardial fat, severity of coronary stenosis, and plaque characteristics. Current imaging biomarkers are fragmented and operating silos. These problems have constrained the cost-effectiveness of CT as a diagnostic tool. But with advancements in machine learning and AI technology, we can now complete the analysis in 10 minutes, which is more than 10 times faster than the traditional approach. This technology improves productivity and optimizes healthcare workforce and resources. Secondly, AI reduces variability in reporting. It assists clinicians in objectively interpreting CT images, diagnosing and monitoring the severity of disease and treatment response. Thirdly, AI goes into a greater depth of detail. It provides physicians with unprecedented insights into a patient's condition to effectively carry out personalized care and early intervention. This would delay disease onset and prevent adverse events from happening. In order to capitalize on the value these AI toolkits can bring, a centralized service platform is needed to integrate them into the current clinical workflow so that physicians can adopt them in routine clinical practice. Welcome to Apollo Platform. The platform integrates AI toolkits into the current clinical workflow to benefit patients and make a real impact. This platform allows automated anonymization, reporting, calcium scoring, coronary stenosis, and plaque characterization. It also provides a one-stop platform spanning from diagnosis, management to prognosis, and aiding predicting therapy response to pharmaceutical treatments. The Apollo platform creates a tremendous impact on three levels. Firstly, the Apollo platform shortens the processing time for image analysis and diagnosis. This also allows accurate assessment of plaque burden in coronary artery disease. This will undoubtedly be attractive to pharma, medtech, and SME research and development investment in Singapore. Secondly, Apollo provides objective and consistent clinical trial endpoint measurements at a cheaper cost. This will increase the probability of success and reduce timelines in drug discovery and development. Thirdly, the Apollo platform provides a rich resource for SMEs to build their AI technologies for CT. All these will strengthen Singapore's position in healthcare across the region. The Apollo platform consists of four AI modules which can perform different AI analysis of CT images. First, AI calcium score allows the quantification of calcium score, volumetric score, and detection of calcified vessels. Second, AI EAT allows the quantification of total volume of epicardial fat and density. Third, AI stenosis allows the quantification of stenosis severity and detection of stenosis location. Last, AI plaque allows the quantification of plaque volume and characterization of plaque type and the number of plaques. The four modules provide a one-stop solution to detect high-risk plaque and risk-stratified patients. We are building a large shareable, de-identified, TDPA-compliant curated digital warehouse of CT real-world data from three hospitals. Secondly, we are creating an integrated AI platform for anonymization and reporting of coronary calcium, epicardial fat, stenosis, and plaque quantification to be used in large-scale clinical trials. Thirdly, we will assess the usability and workflow integration of the platform and the ability to provide a rapid assessment of patients' conditions with AI solutions. Lastly, we'll test-bed AI toolkits in different hospitals and pharma trials. The Apollo platform has several business models. Primarily, we're focusing on healthcare institutions and physicians. The platform implementation includes a one-time setup fee, followed by a yearly subscription fee. Secondly, Apollo is used as an objective quantitative tool in clinical trials to test the effectiveness of drugs and treatments. For example, pharmaceuticals can develop and choose from a range of medications and determine if they inhibit buildup of plaque, prevent atherosclerosis, and reduce the risk of heart attacks. Thirdly, Apollo can be used to anchor the medical technology industry in Singapore through collaborations in technical development via service agreement on a per-contract basis. Our team comprises of medical physicians, AI scientists, and tech experts to support and grow with our customers. We have a dedicated project manager to ensure test-bedding success. Cardiovascular disease is the number one killer globally. Our AI-enabled coronary CT angiography identifies, characterizes, and quantifies coronary calcium, epicardial fat, stenosis, and plaque. In addition, the Apollo platform also supports physicians in determining a patient's risk of a future heart attack. This can significantly alleviate the burden to the healthcare system. Thank you very much. At Apollo, we are committed to delivering tomorrow's AI solution on CT for coronary artery disease today.
Hello everyone, I'm Dr. Li from Chongqing University of Posts and Telecommunications. I'm honored to have this opportunity to speak at this IEEE EMBS public web. My presentation will cover the following topic: the application of the photon counting detector technology in the medical image. In this presentation, we will review the recent progress in this field briefly, with the intent of highlighting the relationship between PCT design considerations and potential challenges. In clinical examination, diagnosis system using energy integrating detector is well established. A digital value for each pixel is proportional to the total energy sum of the incident X-rays. As shown in the diagram upper left, in conventional energy integrating detector, an incident X-ray photon is converted into visible light photons in a scintillator. These visible light photons are absorbed by a photodiode, which measures the amount of light and generates an electrical signal proportional to the total energy during a measurement rather than the energy of an individual X-ray photon. In recent years, the introduction of photon counting detector is expected to be the next major breakthrough in clinical diagnosis field. Photon counting detector, aka PCDs, on the other hand, consist of a single thick layer on which a large voltage is applied. If an incident X-ray is absorbed, it generates a cloud of positive and negative charges and pulled away from each other. The moving charges generate an electrical pulse in the pixelated anode, which is contacted with readout ASIC. PCDs thus convert the X-ray photon directly into an electrical signal. Photon counting has broad application across all walks of life. However, it's mainly applied to different market fields according to the characteristic performance on the count rate or energy resolution. Generally, applications can be graded by flux rate. Both third generation and spectral CT require flux rates from 10 to 100 megatons per square millimeter in 1 second to avoid pile up. There are currently two main converter material candidates, cadmium zinc tellurate and silicon. Their properties are summarized in Table 1, which is cited from the review paper of Professor Danielson last year. The pixelated CCT detector has a face-on geometry after the crystal sensitive area is further divided with segmented anode. This traditional sandwich geometry may lead to spectral enhancement because of the famous small pixel effect. Current state of art allows one to develop large area gamma ray CCT detector, which widely used in the spectral system, like this OMS CCT module. Despite many years of development, PCDs have only recently approached the performance necessary for being used in clinical CT scanner after researchers developed the silicon strip PCD. The main challenge are achieving good performance at high count rate and manufacturing a full field detector with sufficiently low density of imperfections at a low cost. As it's not feasible to make the wafers much thicker than a few millimeters, the silicon wafers are mounted edge-on with respect to the incoming X-rays. The effective depth of this edge-on silicon detector is determined not by the thickness of the silicon wafer, but by the length of the wafer. One of the advantages of this geometry is reducing the count rates per channel and providing additional energy resolution simultaneously. Silicon strip detector has lots of advantages. However, compared to a CCT detector, constructing a full-field silicon detector is more complex because of the edge-on sensor geometry. And the wide bandgap material-based PCDs have been developed in past decades for different applications. It's still one of the potential solutions for next-generation spectral CT detector. We will manage the development of CCT material-based PCDs in order to clarify the main challenges of this traditional technology. Similar to other spectral detectors, CCTPCDs detect all energy levels simultaneously, which means that there are no temporal changes between the beams that may introduce artifacts. There is no special protocol needed, so spectral information is in principle available for all scans. For now, the CCT detector has been considered as advanced detection technology in certain fields of medical diagnosis. GE company already developed four different imaging systems based on CCT technology. CCT is one of the most common used direct conversion materials. Its density and high effective atomic number give it high stopping power for typical energies of interest in SPECT and CT. It has greater linear attenuation coefficient than most of scintillators. The zinc content varies from different suppliers. It often contains trace amount of other elements that are used to improve the electric properties. CCT crystal is generally grown as a single crystal, and then the crystal is cut into wafers, polished, and the metal contacts are depleted on the surface to extract the electrical signals. Current photon counting detector may not attain the performance of an ideal one, and several challenges that we must overcome are already identified at this point. There are three typical issues in the PCDs which are listed in this slide. The decades research already reveals that the higher atomic number of CCT material results in higher absorption and less scattering. But on the other hand, the higher flux leads to degraded spectral response due to the catastrophic post pile-up and the crosstalk between pixels. In fact, 100 million photons per square millimeter in 1 second flux has been a typical input for the detector in CT scans. However, much faster circuit would be required since the generation of radiation is a random process. A number of incident X-ray photons would be lost due to post-pile-up. A much faster comparator is required to process pulses in short time, and thus, a more sophisticated circuit design is imperative. In real photon counting detection, two different crosstalks between pixels can also be attributed to fluorescence and charge sharing, respectively. As shown in the central diagram, X-ray photon only depleted part of its energy in detector element where it hits. The rest of the energy is carried away by the fluorescence photon. The common crosstalk effect, as we know, is another phenomenon when photon is absorbed on the border between two pixels. Part of the generated charges are recorded in each of the two pixels. Although the discussion about the CCT material is not in the scope of this presentation, manufacturing of large-sized crystals is a practical challenge. The crystals generally suffer from lattice defect and impurities that lead to charge trapping. Charge trapping limits the charge connection efficiency for individual events and may also cause long-term polarization effects as shown in the right diagram. All these listed issues could degrade the image quality by deteriorating spatial resolution, increasing signal noise or CNR. Even though CCT-PCD system suffers from these technical limitations, the intrinsic limitations are relatively few after using advanced ASIC and CCT-PCDs, still have a huge potential for the future. In spectral information detection, the precision and accuracy of different energy beams and the spectral information are not determined only by material properties, but are also determined by the detector electronics, and hence, ASIC performance is critical for PCDs. The PCDs has similar front-end circuit design for now. The generated current signal is integrated in a charge-sensitive pair amplifier, aka CSA. At the output of CSA, we obtain a voltage step proportional to the total charge generated in the detector. The voltage step is sent to the shaper, which provides pulse shaping according to the timing requirements and to maximize the SMR. Further processing of the shaped signal can be done in different ways depending on specific applications. Possible options are shown. The first one is based on binary readout architecture. In this case, the comparator detects the signal above the threshold and provides 1-bit discrimination information in response. The second way of processing the shaped signal employs an ATC, where the amplitude of the signal is measured. The third circuit is used for timing measurement, determination of the time of occurrence. Nowadays, the constraints of the chip size and power consumption make the ideal architecture difficult to realize in practice. If we concentrate on applications for fast X-ray scan, the architecture with one or few discriminators in one single channel could be used. The existing solutions have up to 9 discriminators per single channel, and for spectral CT system, the energy beam is usually 3 to 6. The counters after the discriminators store the information about the numbers of the effective births. As each channel works independently, this architecture is suitable for very high flexible X-ray scan. Our ASIC team developed a multi-channel ASIC CPME, which working as a front-end readout of CCD sensors for possible SPECT or gamma camera systems. This CPME ASIC consists of 128 channels in parallel as shown in the drawing. A total of 2 test post inputs are provided that allows for calibrations of all channels via 0.1 picofarad capacitor. Moreover, there is a circuit block for the reset, a block for bias generation and distribution, and the backend circuit and the interface module to the system are also designed. As shown in the right diagram, each channel contains a no noise, no power CSA, a shaper, a discriminator module, which contains a peak sample hold circuit and a trigger generation branch. The discriminator having externally determined the thresholds, enabling simple energy discrimination. Fine adjustment of individual thresholds is possible using 5-bit internal trim DSs, which are preloaded from a serial shift register. The backend of the ASIC receives a sample and hold signal and initiates a readout sequence after receiving the trigger. For a triggered channel, the analog output is multiplexed to the output buffer. The channel address is bit encoded. The communication is asynchronous. The acquisition system must detect the external trigger at the trigger pad and sample the digital address and MGO signal. Then the acquisition system shall send a snagging post to the ASIC, which will output the analog pulse height, as well as resetting the trig and the internal circuit. A global in signal, which is used for blocking any other channels from triggering, is also required for the ASIC as soon as the trigger signal is detected. The detailed time sequence is shown in the upper left diagram. The detailed simulation work has also been accomplished before the fabrication of this ASIC. Here we provide some typical response of different modules when equivalent 1.5 FC charge has been sent into the chosen channel. The gain of CSA is 10, and the peaking time is adjustable from 0.35 microsecond to 1 microsecond. This ASIC is implemented in 0.35 CMOS technology and already fabricated on April this year. The chip aimed to use the for detection of gamma ray with energies range up to 200 keV or in 1 mega EV range and read up to 125 kHz per chip. The amplifiers are optimized for negative input charge up to 50 FC maximum. Each channel has an optional current compensation for detector leakage current. The chip has a 813 memory registers, which are announced one to set various functions, program DAC, and two parameters. The total power consumption is about 150 milliwatts maximum. For now, a total 512-channel detector module has already been fabricated and the ASIC test is undergoing. The verification results of the ASIC and the detector performance will be presented in days in the form of research papers. There is no doubt that photocounting is a promising technology on the verge of becoming clinical feasible and has the potential to dramatically change the clinical use of the different medical system in the upcoming decades. I sincerely appreciate that at this opportunity to share our research experience with distinguished experts in IEEE EMBS. If anyone who like more information or has questions, please feel free to contact me according to my email. Thank you very much for your kind attention. Thank you.
First of all, thank you very much for the invitation to speak at the IEEE day and for EMBS. I'm Rosa Chen. I'm currently from Hong Kong. And today I will talk a little bit about some of my research on neuromodeling and how do we move from computational theory to application. So the first question we want to ask is like, why engineers want to study neuroscience? Why do we want to understand the computational theory better? First of all, we want to understand or quantify the neurobiological basis of cognition. Why do we perform certain things, or why do we behave in a certain way? So the other important message in this work is that we hope that we can develop neuroprosthetic devices for those who lost some functions because of a nervous system disorder or disease. And third, in terms of engineering, after we have learned so much about how the nervous system works, we want to ask if we may enhance human-computer interaction experience through what we learned from neuroscience. So how do we quantify the neural system? So first of all, we identify the first building block of the brain, which is the neurons. So for neurons, if we take a look at it from the point of view of an engineer, we can treat the first part as dendrites for each neuron. That is a you can treat it as a local nonlinear analog lossy input signal integrator. And you have SOMA, which is as a global nonlinear analog loss input signal integrator. And then you have axons, it's sort of a long-distance lossless coupled cable with relatively short propagation delay. And these action potentials are like a binary or digital outputs. And the second part is that like it's a synapse that like we can model as a these synapses, which are neural junctions. And so they have scalable connection weight and which represents like memory and learning and majority of our brain these chemical synapses. So how do we model from a single neurons to the network? So traditionally you have a Hodgkin-Huxley model and also cable functions, but still like if we want to make it to applications, we have to look into input output driven models instead of like simulating mechanistically. So right now there are quite a number of like available neural measurements ranging from fMRI, EEG, spike trains, etc. And these recording methods can be invasive or non-invasive. And invasive give you a higher resolution data, but saying that it requires surgical implant. But for non-invasive recording methods, for example, EEG or so-called brain waves, so which is more convenient to use and low cost, but at the same time, you lost some of the spatial resolution. but it still gives you a very good like temporal resolution. So using these neural recordings, there are different types of neuroprosthesis developed. So if we treat our human body, so take a look at it in terms of like, from the point of view of engineers, we can divide it into three parts. First part is the sensory component, that is the sensors. Second part is the for cognition, and the third part is for actuation. In order to like substitute or like complement some of the lost sensory function, such as because of blindness or like loss of hearing, so there are like artificial retina or even cochlear implant developed. So, and the other kind of prosthesis, so imagine for those like who lost their limbs because of some accident or disease, and you may have seen a lot of these on news already. There are even like DIY motor prosthesis and for all these subjects. And you can see that in a lot of different projects you can find online. In our lab, what we try to do is to also develop better motor prosthesis at some point. So we actually study a lot about the brain function and how does it relate with muscles and from muscles to the hand function. So you take a look at your hand, it is actually like a puppet. And for this hand, when you send signals to different muscle groups, and the muscles here contract and pulls, the ligaments and tendons, and then so then these this hand start to move accordingly. So, and then in this project, so previously, so we tried to look at okay, so if for those amputees who lost a hand, so for example, like the signals sent to these muscles are still there if they want to move. So can we map those like signals to the intention of moving? And we can show that like using even some simple machine learning techniques, and like even though like we don't know what kind of features that exactly was relating to the movement before, but like we use a toolbox to extract all the features possible. So instead of like just select one, so we try to use like a data-driven approach to find which is the best feature set to map to movement. We can show that like roughly around like 5 to 13 like features is already sufficient to capture so how much weight you want to use in grasping. And if we even just use one single feature, we can still reach a pretty like acceptable like accuracy. Of course, it's not just like only about grasping with weight, but we can also identify different gestures. So as you know, like with convolutional neural network, so we can achieve a very nice like accuracy for a multiple movement, reaching over 80% like accuracy for intersubjects, and over 70% for amputees. So this is a collaboration with like Professor Chongqing of CTU. So afterwards, we take a look at what we found again, and we found that like using electrical signals, all right, which correspond to muscle activities, yes, indeed, it can correspond to like different movement. But how about like for intersubjects like us, what can we tell from in addition to electrical activities, we found that actually at the wrist, when we are moving, actually it also corresponds to some vibration at the wrist area. So because of this, like we also found that like we can map from these vibration to different movements, which can be used for like hand gesture recognition, for wearables, etc. And the other point that we want to show you is that in addition to motor prosthesis, and from there, we also learned a lot about movement, which leads to some of our developments of new hand gesture recognition techniques. We have also like study on how we process our memory. So for memory impairment, for example, like the key point is that like There's a portion of the brain called hippocampus, which encodes short-term memory into long-term memory. So this slide is a courtesy from University of Southern California in Dr. Ted Berger's group. So I was working there when I was a grad student. And so at that time, so my main role is to try to figure out how this piece of tissue, hippocampus, like transform information. And then with that model, then can we implement it on a chipset so that like we can like bypass the damaged region so that we can like encode short-term memory into long-term memory again. So back then, like using this strategy, so there's a they verified on rats that like it can restore part of the memory loss because of some damages. But how do they know that it is working? So it's based on a task called behaved non-matched sample task. There's a control curve over here. So imagine that in this task, there are three phases. First is the sample phase, where either in the chamber, either the left level or right level released it. And the second phase is called delay phase, where in the opposite side of the chamber, a light will go on, and the light will go off in a random interval. So, and then the first stage is called a mesh stage, when the both levers will be released it, and the rat has to press the opposite lever to get the reward. So with this figure, what it shows is that just like where I park my car, and like as the time goes by, I spend more time in my office, I tend to like forget where my car is parked. So the rat does the same thing. If the delay time increases, it tends to forget where is the opposite lever. So one day is performing that task at Wake Forest University. So the from CA3 and CA1 region, they are recording the spike trains. So with all this data, how do we build the model? So this time, like we have to understand how the brain system is connected. So it's a multi-input, multi-output system, and it is the non-stationary and non-linear and dynamical. So which makes the model more difficult is that it's even stochastic. That means that like you need a lot of like observation to reconstruct the what's the underlying firing probability around certain event. So at that time we built this like generalized Laguerre-Volterra model with Dr. Dongsong and Dr. Mavarellas and to like try to build this like model to capture how the information is transformed at hippocampus. And using this model, they applied a stimulation at Wake Forest University, and they found that it can facilitate memory by hippocampus like ensemble stimulation. So after I left the group for a number of years, they also continued research, and there were also exciting findings on like facilitating human like memory encoding recall like using similar like stimulation strategies. However, one of the fundamental questions still we ask is that like the fact is that the neural recording, we are only recording very small subset of neurons, given you have so many billions of neurons. So how do we study a sample network? So one of the attempts by one of my previous students, he is now working in TikTok China or ByteDance. And what he found is that actually with all these neurons, all right, recording, and that he can get from like public database, he found that there exists some like complex network structure. For example, like in the hippocampus, he found that it exists smaller features, which means that it's a relatively small average path length, but like high clustering coefficients, and which means that most nodes are not neighbors of one another, then both nodes can be reached from every other by a very small number of steps. So we just something called the small world network, and you can find this in social network too. But what we found is that like we have to also take care of the fact that we have only measured a very small number of neurons. So after that like preliminary study, he did a lot of simulations. So he simulated a much larger set of neurons, and then he tried to simulate the what if in cases that only part of the only some of the neurons can be recorded. So surprisingly, he found that there exists a small awareness measure that that is sort of related to the number of sample neurons. And this relationship can be no matter what's the, you can see all these different dots correspond to different original number of neurons and the number of sample neurons. And he found that it follows a certain trend. So which means that there's an adjustment that we can follow if we know how many neurons we sampled. And then after this adjustment, he actually found that, so we are in this area. So with this adjustment, so he still found that hippocampus is a small network. So what else have we done? So we also had a lot of applications ranging from for those model subjects and even measuring not only the neural recordings, but also from movement recording from multiple sensors for various applications. For example, we did a multi-user study around 10 years ago for EEG. So multiple subjects wearing, each of them are wearing a EEG headset. We try to adopt it for educational psychology or to understand group dynamics in entertainment. And with even just a simple wearable EEG, and we found that there are certain measures or some EEG features that we can track that relate with mental load in different cognitive and motor tasks. And but we also have to consider the area that we're recording, which is at the frontal region. So which means that there are certain tasks, for example, rotation tasks, that is sort of more visual, imaginary related, that is not performing as good as the other tasks, calculation or or linguistic tasks. At the same time with EEG, so with we can also found that with appropriate artifact removal, we found that we can use it for visual feedback for gait training, and which can so we try to study if the visual feedback is efficient. And one of the final year project students of my team, he also has a recent startup on the development of in-ear sensing device for motor task classification. So what we have learned so far, so for tasks with a relatively few outputs, so traditional machine learning techniques with feature extraction, feature selection, and classification are quite sufficient. And if there are lots of electrophysiological data available, convolutional neural network performs the best. And handling time variance of neurodynamics will be important in the development of lifelong neural prostheses. But at the same time, we also observe other limitations. There will be limited duration and the number of electrophysiological recordings available, and the working environment and tasks change over time. So that means there are limitations in real life performance. So that's why we have also collaboration projects with the industry. We try to fuse, let's say, robotic vision to enhance the assistive device using even just using a subset of electrophysiological recordings. So we have a data set, open data set that is capturing a lot of different objects in the real life environment. And these data sets are available for download. So hopefully with all these studies, In addition to understand better the in terms of the neuroscience, we can also develop better real life applications. And also we can also see that like better understand neuroscience indeed like help the development of better machine learning algorithms. With that, I will close my presentation. And then this is actually a joint effort for lots of researchers around the world. And it's my great pleasure to work with them. And if you have any other questions, you're welcome to contact me through rosa_chan@IEEE.org. Currently, I'm the Asia Pacific representative for IEEE EMBS. And I'm also the editorial board on Journal of Neural Engineering and also the area editor of Encyclopedia Brain. So thanks again for the invitation by EMBS chapter development committee for me to share my research with you. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Hamid Gholam Hosseini. I am associate professor at AUT, and my colleague is associate professor Peng from University of Auckland. We are talking about biomedical engineering in research and clinical translations from the New Zealand North chapter. Giving you a bit background about the chapter, IEEE New Zealand is grouped into Region 10, Asia Pacific of IEEE, and has three sections, the New Zealand North, Central, and South. The EMBS chapter is one of the 12 active chapters of the New Zealand North and has been active in developing and offering professional programs, technical papers, engineering conferences and workshops, and student activities. Especially, we've been helping with the establishment of a new chapter, new student branch at AUT. This chapter intends to bid for one of the future of annual international IEEE EMBS conferences, which is the flagship conference in the EMBS society. So here is some activities that we've been involved, especially participating in the EMBS conferences. And we start talking about some of the research that is going on in our area. So the research that we are talking is trying to focus on the New Zealand Health Strategy Future Direction, which has been proposed by Ministry of Health from 2016 to 2026. So this strategy is mainly focusing on having for all New Zealanders to live well, to stay well and get well. And this strategy is mainly around five schemes, which is mainly trying to bring smarter health services to the community and focusing on people power and managing long-term condition and then prevention of the problems, which is called as a close-to-home services, and increasing the value and high performance for the health service, and especially adding decision support system to the primary care level, and integration of health services, which is happening now in New Zealand as one team type of scheme, and using innovative new technology, point of care, access health record using the smart system. So these schemes are interlinked. So we got the idea from these strategies. And then one of the projects that we've been working on is related to electronic general practitioner, which we call it EGP. This is a cross-platform mobile applications that has different type of components. I will talk more about vital assist project and the wearable vest and cuffless blood pressure. These two projects are aiming to look at the providing smarter health and introducing mobile application to the health and also managing LTC or long-term conditions. We are using some of the off-the-shelf product like a smart shirt from HexoSkin, which is a wearable device, and it has embedded sensors, which we can monitor the vital signs and the activities of the person. There are other components of the EGP, like skin cancer detection, which we are using AI or artificial intelligence and machine learning techniques, especially deep learning, for addressing the early diagnosis of melanoma. This can be addressed the decision support system of the health strategy, and it can help the GP at the primary health level to diagnose these type of issues. There is another component which is dealing with the electronic health record, especially when we are talking about integration of health services. It is important to have an electronic health record available from everywhere at any time. And we need also to consider security and privacy of the data using techniques like software-defined primitive or other type of cybersecurity techniques. And then the last component is Internet of Things, which mainly try to help particular patients like older adults, and we use it for fall prevention and fall detection. And also big data, there are data science that can extract more meaningful information from the big data that is available. So this project, as I mentioned, one component was vital sign or vital sign monitoring, which we call it Vital Assist application, which is a mobile phone application for health. And the focus of this project was to implement vital sign collections and monitoring in acute care setting in the hospital for better decision making. So through this project, we achieve efficient bedside data collection of routine observations, and we try to reduce time taken for alerting a critical care outreach team through automated presentation of the early warning scores. And this project also was tested for having timely escalations and response to deterioration through integrated of medical devices and clinical decision support system. And we managed to implement this project as an end-to-end patient monitoring application or solution for iOS and Android devices. And then we integrated this application to the Orion Health Smart Data Platform, which is being used in the hospital, and we can use it for final clinical trial. So that is one of the projects related to the EGP. Another project that we've been involved is cuffless blood pressure monitoring, which is a very popular area of research. And this project is using an application of pulse transit time, calculating of pulse transit time, which has a relation with the blood pressure. So how we do that, we can measure the time taken by pulse wave to travel between two pulses in the cardiovascular system using wearable devices like a finger clip pulse oximeter and a small ECG data collection. So by developing an app, we've been able to collect these two signals. One is ECG, another is PPG, and then we can extract the heart rate, we can extract oxygen saturation, and more importantly, we can calculate the systolic blood pressure, which can be used continuously to monitor the blood pressure, and is important for long-term condition. And there are other projects which I am also part of, those happening in the AUT Institute of Biomedical Engineering, Biomedical Technology, IBTech. And this area is mainly focusing on new technology to achieve better health outcome. So among this project, we are looking at accurate measuring of electrical signals like EEG from the brain, ECG from the heart, or EMG from the muscle activities, with the aim of having accurate signals by having a better preparation of the skins and using better type of electrodes to do that. So this is a project that we call it EXGWARE, and it has been funded by the government, and this attracted lots of other research institutes in New Zealand that are working to that application. And as a transformation and translation of our research, we can have one example from a company called PartsCore. This PartsCore Limited, in collaboration with the Institute of Biomedical Technology at AUT, been successful to investigate the physics behind the blood pressure measurement. And the company also funded lots of research at the university and supported students, postgraduate students, and other projects. And this project was successful in terms of bringing innovation to the field, and it has been commercialized in the USA and Europe, and has since been bought by an Australian public medical device company, which is a translation of some of these research. So I hand over to my colleague, Professor Peng, to explain about other projects.
Thank you, Hamid. I'm always impressed by the depth and breadth of your research, and greetings and kia to the audience. And I'd like to also thank the organizers for this opportunity for us to speak. So over the next second half of the talk, I'd like to cover some of the work that I've been involved in on the human gut as an example of applications of engineering techniques in the by researchers and students at the New Zealand North Chapter on biomedical engineering and its potential translation. So to talk about, you know, the motivation of our work, I must go back almost a century there. To the first instance of reported bioelectrical recordings from the human gut by a clinician called Walter Alvarez in the States. He was lucky enough to have a female patient who had cancer, actually, and had, as a result, had most of her abdominal wall removed. So he could actually see the contractions going on in her stomach. So in a study that would not be approved by any ethics committee today, he tunneled few wires through her skin onto her stomach. And from those wires, he recorded these oscillations that you can see on the screen. And because he could see the peristaltic contractions in her gut, he deduced that, much like all the other muscles in the human body, the activities in the gut are also governed by a bioelectrical event. And this is, at the time, this was very exciting work because at the same time, electrophysiology in the heart and the brain were also just taking off. And forward 100 years, electrophysiology in the heart has formed EP labs all over the world, employing state-of-the-art machineries, developing customized mathematical models of the human heart, looking at the effects of real-time, in real-time interventions. Yet, in comparison, you know, the bioelectrical activity in the gut has not really been used or achieved a similar level of clinical translation. So there's a bit of missed opportunity here. And in fact, it's been called a seductive promise, but only partially kept. So over the past 10 years or so, the gut research group at the Auckland Bioengineering Institute at the University of Auckland have been investigating the electrical activation of the human stomach. So what you see here are mathematical simulations of the activation sequence of the human stomach, with the red activity representing depolarized or active tissues in the stomach. So as you can see, that in the normal case, we have these very organized bands of activity going down the stomach. In comparison, in the abnormal case, in this case, a case of reentry, we have sustained activity that occurs in an ectopic sense that would disrupt the normal activity of the stomach. And when this happens over a long period of time, as you can imagine, this would disrupt the normal efficiency at which the stomach empties its contents and causes all sorts of problems. And one of the things that the engineers have been working on are applications and development of a series of recording probes used to measure the activity of the gut, all the way from the very in vitro research tools such as a microelectrode array, all the way to arrays that we can deploy during surgery, as well as sensors that we can put on the body surface. And we started out with the more surgical and invasive option because those give us the best quality data. But as our hardware becomes more clinically applicable, we are gradually reducing the invasiveness while increasing its clinical update. So some of the more exciting work that have been occurring over the past 2 years presented at the EMBC in 2021 and 22 were applications of conductive polymer electrodes. So those involve state-of-the-art chemistry involving conductive polymer, and these electrodes will be biocompatible, therefore can be incorporated as a potential implantable device, as well as incorporating multiple types of sensors. So beyond measuring just the electrical activation, we have plans to measure things like changes in pH, as well as strains in the gut. And jumping to the more clinically translational aspects of our work, we've recently also launched a company called Allometry, which looks at recording the activity of the gut from the body surface using a sensor array. So what you see on the left is a photo of the product with the blue patch as the sensor of electrodes in an 8x8 configuration. This is a wearable device that clips onto the sensor array and it's placed on the abdominal surface of the patient over a 4-hour period. We then validated this device by taking recordings simultaneously from the surface of the stomach of an animal subject, as well as the surface of its abdominal wall. So this is part of our preclinical validation. So this basically allows us to look at the relationship between activity from the gut directly. So those are the activity from the serosal surface. You can see from the middle graph there, as well as simultaneous recordings obtained from the body surface. So this gives us a way to validate, much like an ECG, the relationship between body surface recording and the activity generated by the organ. We then applied this device clinically in a group of patients suffering from chronic nausea and vomiting. And what we've discovered in that case compared to the control were subcategories of this previously one category of disease where, you know, the functions of the gut electrically might be normal in a subset of those patients, suggesting that perhaps the fact those patients are feeling sick were not due to the gut, but something else. And in fact, there's another subgroup of patients that showed an abnormality in their gut bioelectrical activation, suggesting that yes, in those patients, the arrhythmia in the gut would be a cause of disease. So this device basically allows us a better stratification or classification of the different phenotypes or causes of diseases. And finally, we're also interested in looking at potential interventional measures. And this is by targeting the brain-gut axis. So in collaboration with Professor Yusuf Kekmak from the University of Otago, again, we followed our preclinical to clinical translational pathway by first looking at what happens if we modulate the vagus nerve in the animal subjects by taking recordings directly from the stomach. There we showed that these neuromodulation protocols could indeed have an effect on the gut. We then took these protocol and setups to actual human subjects and demonstrated that By applying these protocols in the normal human subjects, we could normalize behaviors of the gut in response to a water load test. And these will be used as the basis for future clinical intervention of neuromodulation in order to modulate the activities of the gut. And finally, as other aspects of the work at the Auckland Bioengineering Institute involve mathematical modeling, so these involve reconstruction of the microstructures of the gut, including its musculatures as well as its distribution of nerves, and we can create predictive mathematical simulations that incorporate the different physiological parameters, as well as making them available in an open access manner online, in order to facilitate further translation and uptake of mathematical modeling by experimental physiologists. You know, our long-term vision in this case then is to create this concept of the virtual gut, where every aspect of the gut are developed as a mathematical model, informed by experimental data. Once validated, those models could then be used in turn to perform predictive simulations of potential diagnostic procedures or treatment options. Finally, we'd like to again acknowledge the IEEE EMBS Chapter Development Committee 2022, and you can see our emails on the slide in case you're interested to get in touch. We always welcome friends from all over the world. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you.